He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Hey guys, I wanted to show you some more stuff on ChemDoodle 3D today. This time I wanted to show you about some unit cells that will be adopted by various ionic compounds. And before we look at some ionic compounds, I just wanted to start with the very simplest thing. So I just loaded polonium. This is a single polonium atom. And what we can do here is build out the cell and see what happens. So let's just do two. Let's do two cells. And so we can start to see how this is going to get built out. And this is actually the true unit cell for polonium. This is a simple cubic structure. And what the unit cell would be is just having these eight atoms at the corners of the cell. And so this is really the simplest structure that can be adopted by any metal or anything like that. And in fact, this polonium is the only metal that adopts this this structure. So this is the simplest thing that we can see. We can build this out even further. Let's do five of them. And so you can really see how this is considered a simple cubic structure. There's really no simpler repeating unit in three dimensions. So that's what this is gonna look like. And so now we can move on to some more complex situations. Let's get rid of this. So now we're looking at cesium chloride. We've got cesium ions, or CS plus in purple. We've got chloride ions, or Cl minus in green. And let's see what happens if we build this out. Let's just go to two. And what we end up with here is something that, if these were all the same element, this would be a body-centered cubic structure, which is slightly more complex because we see the simple, basically the same orientation we had before, but there's an additional atom in the center of that lattice. And so if they were all the same element, we'd be calling it a body-centered cubic structure. And a lot of metals do crystallize that way. But because this is an ionic compound and we have two different elements, we are not going to call it a body-centered cubic. It is actually still a simple cubic structure if we consider the cesium ions forming a simple cubic structure. And then the chloride ions are filling all of the cubic holes. So when ionic compounds crystallize, they want to make the best use of the space as possible. They want to fill up all the space so that they can maximize the ion-ion interactions in the lattice. And so that's what this is going to form. And we can even take a look at this without those bonds if we want to see this a little more clearly. So here we can see that this is a simple cubic structure. And the interesting thing is you can consider it a simple cubic structure with either of the elements. So we could consider the cesium ions as forming the simple cubic structure and the chloride ions occupying the cubic holes. Or we could flip it and we could say that the chloride ions are forming a simple cubic structure and the cesium ions are filling the cubic holes. Either way, whichever way you want to look at it, it's the same thing. And let's build this out a little more. How about let's do four. And now we can really see quite a bit of structure here. We can rotate this a number of ways. And that's what we're looking at. Once again, let's go ahead and remove those bonds. And we can really see this is still quite a simple structure, right? This is about as simple as ionic compounds can get. And of course, this depends greatly on the relative sizes of the ions here. The sizes of the ions are quite similar, but this changes a little bit when the sizes of the ions become quite disparate. So let's take a look at another one. Let's get rid of this. Okay, we're now looking at zinc sulfide. So the zinc ions are here in gray and the sulfide ions are in yellow. And so let's build this out just a little bit so we can get a better sense of this unit cell. And this is actually a face-centered cubic structure. So that is where the sulfide ions are forming the unit cell. centered in the faces of the cube, and then the zinc ions are filling the tetrahedral holes formed by that structure. So this is what this one looks like, and we can build that out even a little more. Let's just do three. And so we can see that this is a little bit of a different structure, and this is mainly because of the discrepancy in the sizes of the ions. So the larger chloride ions are going to form that lattice, and then the zinc ions are going to just fill in the gaps. They're going to fill in those tetrahedral holes. And so this is typically the case that the anion is going to form the unit cell, with the cation filling in the gaps. But we can see the reverse as well. So let's take a look at something else. So now we're looking at calcium fluoride. So we've got Ca2 plus ions in green, and then the F minus fluoride ions over here. These are the smaller ones. And so now we're looking at something where we've got a 1-to-2 ratio, right? Earlier we were looking at 1-to-1 ratios of cation to anion. Now we have one calcium ion for every two fluoride ions. So we can see the discrepancy in the number there. And now we're also looking at, we're looking at a difference in the size of the ions. So it is actually the calcium ions, the cations this time, that are going to form the face-centered cubic structure, while the fluoride ions are going to fill in the tetrahedral holes. Though in this case, they will only fill half of the tetrahedral holes. So let's go ahead and build this out just a little bit. And we can get a better sense of this. And so this is obviously a more complex unit cell because we're not 1-to-1, right? This is not as simple as cesium chloride, where we can just have repeating cubes, right? We do have to allow for the fluoride ions all to be making contacts with these calcium ions. And we can get rid of these bonds. Sometimes it's easier to just remove the bonds so we can get a better sense of how this looks. So that's this one, a little bit more complex. And once again, we saw previously that the anions were forming the face-centered cubic, also known as cubic closest packing. So that's another way of calling it with the face-centered cubic structure. And so earlier we saw the anions forming that structure. Now we're seeing the cations forming that structure. So once again, it just depends on the relative sizes of the ions in terms of what these are going to do. Let's go ahead and look at one more. So here we have a form of aluminum oxide called corundum. So this is Al2O3. So it's even more complex in terms of the ratio between the cation and anion. So we've got Al3 plus in gray, and then O2 minus in red. And this is going to form a rhombohedral structure. So they're not all cubic, and there's actually many, many of these, so we won't go through all of them, but I wanted to show you one weird one. And so this is called rhombohedral. We can see that it's not at all like the cubic structure that we looked at. And so let's build this out once again just a little bit. Let's just do three of these since it's rather complex. So here's that. We've built the unit cell out quite a bit, and we can look at this from a few different vantage points. We can zoom in if we like and really get a good look at this thing. We can also, once again, get rid of those bonds if we want a little bit of a clearer picture of the orientation. And so that's just a little bit about these unit cells. So we looked at the simple cubic cell, which, you know, just for polonium is pretty much what exhibits that in terms of a metal. And then certain ions are going to exhibit that unit cell with other ions filling in cubic holes. We saw what would have been a body-centered cubic cell. We saw face-centered as well. So that's another cool feature of ChemDoodle 3D. It's not just for covalent compounds. We can look at ionic compounds too. You can download any CIF file and just drag and drop right onto the screen here. And then you can play with the dimensions of the unit cell. You can spin it around, really get a good sense of how this thing looks in three dimensions. There's a lot of different things to toggle, and you can really just any ionic compound you can think of, you can put it on here and take a look at what it looks like. So it's a little easier to visualize than just the two-dimensional representations in your textbook. So I do find this useful for getting a better sense of these lattice structures and what the geometry is within them. So if you want to check out ChemDoodle, go ahead and take a look at the link in the description of this clip. It's very affordable. I recommend it. And otherwise, I'll see you next time.
Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.